My name is Sanjeev Dasipur and I lead blockchain for Accenture. So I think we had been having good discussion on Nitin when he started with saying that there are a lot of challenges. And then we went to the other spectrum where we felt that there are a lot of use cases which we can solve. So let me talk about what we call as post-digital era is upon us. The theme is post-digital era, because we look at digital ledger technology more as a post-digital era. So how many of you in this room identify yourself with digital technology? Anybody? What are the digital technology? Pardon? Okay, apart from that. So anybody, what is famously called as digital technology? Yeah? Okay, yeah. So SPAC. Predominantly SPAC is considered to be the digital technology, social, mobility, analytics, and cloud. So now we're talking about post-digital technologies, which are going to be reality. Okay, like DLT is one of them, digital ledger technology. So that's what I'm going to talk about. Like what exactly we feel is going to be the post-digital era will look like. We did a survey with around 6,500 plus IT executives and business executives, and we found out that almost 94% of them have a good digital strategy, and they are onto some amount of maturity in the digital learning. So they have a real estate which is Mac enabled, the way in which we call it from a digital technology. So now, how do they expand on that? How do they get onto the next level of technologies, like digital distributed ledger technology or blockchain as we call them, or AI, or quantum, or extended reality? So these are what we call it as post-digital technologies, okay? So if you see what's important in a post-digital era is that it's all about personalization to individualization. So how do you understand somebody as an individual? I think that becomes extremely important. Okay, so how will technology enable you to understand you? As you said, you are a digital. So can I have a digital twin of you? If I have a digital twin of you, then I can do a lot of things with you. Because that's become individualization of you as a person, or I understand you as a digital person. Ecosystem. I think all of you who have some interest in blockchain, or you are in the field of blockchain, you understand ecosystems are important. This is a technology where ecosystems are enabled. And the third thing is potential new markets. That's what we are talking about, because we are talking about individual reality and individual markets for an individual person. We are talking about micro markets. We are talking about real-time markets, where if I understand you as a person, can I have a business model just for you? So that's the kind of a business model we are talking about, individual business models. That's where enterprises are moving towards. Now, so today we all have our own reality. So how enterprise can identify those realities, our own individual realities, and then what technology can enable you for that? So that's a very important thing what you have. And that leads to custom markets on demand. Because if I understand you as an individual or as a digital twin, then I can do a lot of things for you. So that's another thing which we call a custom market. And instant gratification, we all live in an instant gratification world today. We're so used to that kind of on-demand services we talk about. So if you see, we come out with a technology vision every year. So we have five trends, if you see there. The first one is the interesting one, and that's where I'm going to do a little bit more deep dive, that called dark power. So it's a very interesting thing. So what we call it is like, from smack we are moving to dark. So that is what we're talking about. So then the second thing is like, it's all about individualization. How do you get to know me? How well you know me, so that you can give me an experience which is very, very individual to me. That's the second trend. The third trend is human plus worker. We all live in a world where we have our own skill sets, but it needs to be augmented with a bot or some artificial intelligence. That's the world we are living in. Whether we like it or not, that's going to be the reality. So we are going to be assisted with a bot or an AI or kind of another knowledge base, which is an automated knowledge base. And the third thing is secure us to secure me. Today, security is not just about an enterprise. How vulnerable you are from an enterprise perspective, it's a vector. because you have other enterprises with whom you work, and if you have vulnerability in your ecosystem, then you also get compromised. So it's extremely important that we are talking about securing us than just securing me. And the third thing is about new markets or individual markets, which I spoke to about. So now coming to the DARC, what is DARC? If you see, DARC is, D stands for the Distributed Ledger Technology. That's the theme of today and tomorrow. AI, extended reality, and quantum. Some of the technology are a little more mature compared to quantum and all, which are still 5 to 10 years away. But rest of the technology are happening. If you see, AI is the most mature, then comes distributed ledger and extended reality. So one is that all of them can add value as an individual technology, but the combinatorial effect of all these technology coming together is extremely powerful. So I'll give you three examples. One example is where we talk about all four technologies coming together, how an automotive giant is using these four technologies to actually getting themselves ready for the post-digital era. So we'll talk about the Volkswagen. If you see, Volkswagen is experimenting with all these four technologies. So they're piloting with all these four of them. For DLT, they are looking at how do I provide identity to your cars? How can I give you blockchain-based identity to the car? So that helps you in a lot of things. How can I do automatic payments at gas stations? The moment you have your identity, car has an identity, the payment is very easy after that. Then comes, how can I make it tamper-proof? Odometers can be tamper-proof. And this is all extremely important when we talk about autonomous car and all. The moment you talk about autonomous cars, then the blockchain network makes actually a lot of sense. Because the different cars have to talk to each other, and identity is extremely important, because if you want to do share data between cars, then identity of these cars become very important. So the way in which identity will be provided is blockchain. So that's what Volkswagen is trying to do. The second thing is like, how do you add AI capabilities to new car models and all? The third thing, they're working on extended reality for doing manuals. How do you train your service engineer for doing actually servicing your cars and all? That's why they're using extended reality. And the fourth one, quantum, which is very important, very useful, is like how to do traffic optimization. Because that's where a huge amount of data crunching which is required, and the current compute infrastructure what we have is not enough. So that's why they're looking at quantum computing. So they are actually experimenting all of them. This is what will get them ready for the post-digital era. So these are all pilots right now. If they do not do it now, they'll be left behind. Okay, so that's very, very important. How do you bring all these four technologies? The next one I'm going to talk about is something what we are doing it in India. So Accenture is actually running a pilot right now with a company called Better Place India. And this is for our own employees, for our women employees, who actually take the cab service, and especially the orders or the radars, where the safety of our women employees is extremely important for us. So what we are doing is like, we have built a blockchain network here, and we're using identity on blockchain along with biometrics, where it's very important to know that the driver who's coming to pick you up, he has the right credential, what kind of a background check has been done on him, does he have the right attestation, where all he has worked. So that is something what we provide. And you do a proper biometric based face ID based recognition and all, where the network provides you trust for one is for the driver to give him all his personal details, which goes and gets stored with all his background details, all the places where he has worked in the past and all. And especially for the gig kind of services what they provide. So that is from the driver perspective. Then the employee, when he gets into the car, she can actually find out that the driver who has come to pick her up, does that person have the right credential? And is it okay for her, and has it been authenticated, because it's a face ID based recognition we do, to know that the driver who has come is the same guy who has the right attestation, because it's extremely important. We do that thing. The important thing is like, this also helps you to build an ecosystem. Once you have these kind of attestation credentials of the different kind of workers who are there, then you can actually add a lot more services. Today we have it only for the, it's like safe drive or passenger safety kind of thing, but you can extend it to for other kind of services also. It can be for your house workers, your housemates and all, you can just extend these kind of solutions. So this is what we are running the pilot right now. And this is something is we are also talking to governments, that how can we extend these kind of services for governments? Because that's where a lot of temporary workers and all are also working. So this is one example of where we are using blockchain, biometrics, combination together, and then we are adding AI-based face recognition and all here. The third thing is extremely important. We launched this particular solution called Flip the Farm, or what we call as the circular supply chain in Davos last month, which is part of the World Economic Forum initiative. So here, what we are saying is, like, if you see the farmers, many of the farmers in different sectors like coffee or milk and all, they're very marginalized. These are very poor farmers, and they really do not get the right money for the produce what they do, and they are usually very marginalized. So can I empower an end consumer to do something for these farmers is the whole concept. Suppose I drink a cup of coffee, and if I like that coffee, do I have the power to find out, first of all, which farm, which part of the globe it came from, and who's the farmer? Can I tip him? So that's the whole thing. Like, a 10 cents or maybe a cent of tip from your side, maybe for a farmer somewhere down in South India or maybe in Colombia, makes a lot of difference. Okay, so that's the whole idea. So because it just sets the right behavior, and this you can do when you have the entire provenance and track and trace, all things what we spoke in the morning from a supply chain, because you know that exactly which farm it is coming from, what is the quality of the harvest, how exactly it moves across the supply chain, and then how it is come to end consumer, which is you and me, and can I tip that particular farm. We're also working with a dairy producer in India, where he also wants to find out that, can I find out this milk is coming from which particular cow? So they want to go down and do the tracking at that level. Okay, so what I'm going to do is that I'm going to run a small video. Supply chain is very difficult, and if you do not use a technology like blockchain, it's almost impossible today to do it. So that's the solution what we actually launched, and we have a consortium right now which we are working towards. We have different players as part of the consortium helping us, and we will be getting more and more. Like, we'll have our dairy producer, we'll have coffee, we have got different spices and all, we are going to add to this particular consortium. And this is part of what we call as the Blockchain for Good initiative, or our sustainability initiative, what we are working on. So this is what I had from a presentation perspective. But in the morning, Nitin said some of the challenges which are there in blockchain. One of the important challenges which we face today is the consortium. The whole blockchain adoption, the challenge is forming the consortium. Okay, because technology works, we know there are use cases which have been tried out. Accenture, Deloitte, a lot of other companies, with academia, everyone has worked on different use cases. We know there are some related use cases. The challenge in adoption is, how do we form the consortium? How are different players in the supply chain are going to come together? What is the motivation for each of the players? And that's where the challenge is. So if we do not overcome those challenges, adoption will take time. So that's where governments play a very important part. Regulators, government, central banks, infrastructure providers play a very important part, where they can actually are in the position of power, where they can mandate it, they can regulate it and say that blockchain is the technology what you should be using, whether it is public distribution of grants, agri grants, fertilizer grants, all kind of the thing. That's where the governments have to make a push, and they play a very important role to actually make adoption of blockchain a reality. Otherwise, it will be a challenge, because without consortium, none of the value case or the business case works out. Because it's not a point solution, it's not a single enterprise solution. It's a multi-enterprise solution, different partners have to come through, it's an ecosystem technology. So I'll leave you with that. So I think I had 15 minutes. If you have any questions, I can take it. Otherwise, thank you.